Blackstone Audio presents Mindswap by Robert Sheckley. Chapter 1. Marvin Flynn read the following advertisement in the classified section of the Stanhope Gazette. Gentleman from Mars, age 43, quiet, studious, cultured, wishes to exchange bodies with similarly inclined Earth gentlemen. August 1st through September 1st. References exchanged. Brokers protected. This commonplace announcement was enough to set Flynn's pulse racing. To swap bodies with a Martian. It was an exciting idea, but also a repellent one. After all, no one would want some sand-grubbing old Martian inside his head, moving his arms and legs, looking out of his eyes and listening with his ears. But in return for this unpleasantness, he, Marvin Flynn, would be able to see Mars. And he would be able to see it as it should be seen, through the senses of a native. As some wished to collect paintings, others books, others women, so Marvin Flynn wanted to acquire the substance of them all through travel. But this, his ruling passion, was sadly unfulfilled. He had been born and raised in Stanhope, New York. Physically, his town was some 300 miles from New York City, but spiritually and emotionally, the two cities were about 100 years apart. Stanhope was a pleasing rural community situated in the foothills of the Adirondacks, garlanded with orchards and dotted with clusters of brown cows against rolling green pastureland. Invincibly bucolic, Stanhope clung to antique ways. Amiably, but with a hint of pugnacity, the town kept its distance from the flint-hearted megalopolis to the south. The IRT 7th Avenue subway had burrowed upstate as far as Kingston, but no farther. Gigantic freeways twisted their concrete tentacles over the countryside, but could not take over Stanhope's elm-lined main street. Other communities maintained a blast pit. Stanhope clung to its antiquated jet field and was content with tri-weekly service. Often at night, Marvin had lain in bed and listened to that poignant sound of a vanishing rural America, the lonely wail of a jetliner. Stanhope was satisfied with itself, and the rest of the world seemed quite satisfied with Stanhope, and willing to leave it to its romantic dream of a less hurried age. The only person whom the arrangement did not suit was Marvin Flynn. He had gone on the usual tours and had seen the usual things. Like everyone else, he had spent many weekends in the capitals of Europe. And he had explored the sunken city of Miami by scuba, gazed at the hanging gardens of London, and had worshipped in the Baha'i Temple of Haifa. For his longer vacations, he had gone on a walking tour across Marie Birdland, explored the lower Ituri rainforest, crossed Xinjiang by camel, and had even lived for several weeks in Lhasa, the art capital of the world. In all of this, his actions were typical of his age and station. But these trips meant nothing to him. They were the usual tourist assortment, the sort of things that any casual vacationer was likely to do. Instead of rejoicing in what he had, Flynn complained of what was denied him. He wanted to really travel, and that meant going extraterrestrial. It didn't seem so much to ask, and yet he had never even been to the moon. In the final analysis, it was a matter of economics. Interstellar travel was expensive. For the most part, it was confined to the rich, or to colonists and administrators. It was simply out of the question for an average sort of fellow. Unless, of course, he wished to avail himself of the advantages of Mindswap. Flynn, with innate small-town conservatism, had avoided this logical but unsettling step. Until now. Marvin had tried to reconcile himself to his position in life, and to the very acceptable possibilities that that position offered him. After all, he was free, gay, and 31, a little over 31, actually. He was personable, a tall, broad-shouldered boy with a clipped black mustache and gentle brown eyes. He was healthy, intelligent, a good mixer, and not unacceptable to the other sex. He had received the usual education, grade school, high school, 12 years of college, and 4 years of postgraduate work. He was well-trained for his job with the Reich Peters Corporation. There, he fluoroscoped plastic toys, subjecting them to stress analysis and examining them for micro-shrinkage, porosity, texture fatigue, and the like. Perhaps it wasn't the most important job in the world, but then, we can't all be kings or spaceship pilots. It was certainly a responsible position, especially when one considers the importance of toys in this world and the vital task of alleviating the frustrations of children. Marvin knew all this, and yet he was unsatisfied. In vain he had gone to his neighborhood counselor. This kindly man had tried to help him.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.